glad to welcome everyone here as part of our Facebook streaming service, and also everyone that's here with us at Genesis Church. We're just getting started with our announcements. Hopefully y'all are having a great morning so far. First thing we want to start with is the Honey Path of Police Department Camp. I first have to give a shout out to Sam Gilmer, who took this picture, and to the Honey Path Chronicle for this picture. And it was an amazing success. I contacted Captain Morris later this week to see how everything was going. For their last day, they had 81 kids at the camp.
Wow.
So they reached a lot of kids in the Honey and Pack area. And right now, it served so many purposes. They had speakers coming in now, and plus the kids got to identify with police officers. That police officers, firefighters, paramedics are not their enemy. And that they are, that 99% of the people who do those things are good people, just trying to do their job, and they're a resource if they're in trouble to come to. And we were just really pleased here at Genesis Church that we were able to give a cash donation to go towards the camp. And also we had members that donated snacks and things, and we made sure all that got to where it was supposed to go. So we were just really thankful to be a part of that. And hopefully we'll be able to be a part of it next year and for many years to come. Have the men send our superstars at Children's Church. Gavin, you recognize that handsome fellow over there? Oh, you ain't being shy now. Everyone that's here, Miss Lisa's going to take your picture, so you'll be on the big board next time. Huh? I understand, buddy. It's rough. So, Miss Darlene had a great lesson last week. They're talking about Joseph, and it went really well. Those are some of the crafts. What Miss Darlene and Miss Lisa do, they always have a craft or something to go along to help reinforce the lesson. Because if you think about it, how do we learn that? Just by blah, 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 and you're probably thinking, wow, isn't that what you do for half the service? But, I mean, with kids, they get their hands on things, and they put it together, and the story comes to life for them, and we're really blessed that we have a couple people that enjoy putting this kind of stuff together. And let's see now. Oh, sorry. I got triggered happy. What's it like, honey, if I don't mess them up on our announcements? Now, y'all, as far as our announcements, not really a whole lot has changed, and I forgot my pen. But we will try and get a prayer list. Any news on anyone that we have on the prayer list? Any updates? Any praise reports? Anything good happening in any week? Y'all, is there anyone that we can add to the prayer list? Hey, Kim.
Travis.
Okay, we will. Do you know Travis's last name?
He's talking about Jericho's brother that passed away.
Okay. I think God's got his hand on Travis right now. But that's really sweet of you to think. I think the folks that were all around Travis, they need a lot of prayer. And we'll certainly lift all them up. Because they're the ones hurting because they're missing Travis a lot. And we need to pray for them too. Yes, ma'am.
My daughter Ashley is having a complicated pregnancy. She's due next month, but her cervix keeps opening.
What is Ashley's last name? Is it
Jenkins?
Jenkins, okay. And we will certainly look her up. Pregnancy is
a lot of pain. She's got a metal rod in her back.
Wow.
She's been in a lot of pain.
Yeah, and your spine does some twisting and turning like you have. And we will certainly lift her up with that for complications to go away and everything be nice, smooth, healthy, and quick.
Thank you.
Y'all, is there anyone else that we can? Yes, ma'am.
My son's grandmother passed away yesterday morning.
The family of Rosie Reese, Ms. Reese had been suffering for a while, and she passed away though unexpectedly. And it's called Family by Shock, and we're gonna add her to the bereavement list. And it's hard enough when you lose someone and you're expecting it, but when it happens out of the blue, that makes it that much worse. Also, someone I don't remember, the family of Jenny Norwood. Jenny was a long time, her and Jeff, they came here. Jenny was baptized here. Jenny was diagnosed with cancer last December, and all of us kind of rallied around her. Her and Jeff and Mindy and their family, and it was the 1 year anniversary yesterday of Jenny passing away. And we just want to remember them. This has been a tough weekend. This couple of kids had their birthdays this weekend. And Jenny passed away of metastatic cancer, and she was just a fighter to the end. She was amazing, and she left a hole in our church, I know, in their family. So we definitely want to lift her up. And also, Debbie, my sister-in-law, asked that we add Sheree Holly. S-H-E-R-R-I-E, Holly, H-O-L-L-E-Y, to the prayer list under health. She just found out some real bad news, and she's in a battle, and we want to lift her and her family up. And y'all, anyone that's listening in, please just put a comment. You can add names in the comments or send me a personal message, and we'll be glad to add them to our prayer list. If you need prayer right away, I'll be glad to pray for folks. I pray for folks all over Facebook. Some of you may have seen some of the prayers I lift up. Prayer works. Let's see now. Technical crew, am I leaving out something? Okie doke. Well, y'all, we're going to have this video, and then the kids are going to go back with Ms. Lisa.
And the offering is in the back.
Oh, and the offering's in the back. It's good to have a good technical crew. It's bad that she has so little to work with sometimes. Okay, that's great.
Everybody's got to line up and use your hand sanitizer.
Yeah, don't feel bad. She makes me in the pool use hand sanitizer, so y'all aren't even bad.
I really can't use hand sanitizer, but it's right here.
I love the sound of kids in church. And we're really fortunate. We have a special group of kids, and we're just real fortunate to have them. All those sounds, the laughs, getting up and dancing in the middle of singing. These kids, our hope is that they will be baptized in this church one day, that they will be married in this church one day, that they will eventually, one of them will end up being on the board, having a Sunday school class. That's our hope on them. And it's just wonderful to hear. Well, y'all, I started off this morning for the message this week, and I wasn't sure what to do because Independence Day is coming up this Saturday, and I thought, well, maybe it might be something about that, and I kept praying, and I initially thought it was going to be something else because on your bulletin it actually is, but sometimes the Holy Spirit sends me off the highway onto something different. I had to fly out to Illinois this week for work. I met someone out there, really good person, just really nice. They're really struggling right now. It's not really with their faith. It's not really with anything going on in their lives. They have have a wonderful family, pretty solid relationship in their immediate family, and some people that they're extremely close to, though, how they're behaving. These people are using anything and anybody to make themselves look good, including members of their family. They basically use family members as props to make themselves look good, to look like family members of the year. Faces are popping in your mind, aren't they, as I'm talking about that. As I started writing this, I started thinking about different people. When things don't go their way, they begin the attacks. When the person starts to question, why are you just showing up 10 minutes with only 10 minutes left in the birthday party and you have your best friends in a camera? Why are you doing this? Then they attack their intelligence. They attack their integrity. Or they attack their emotions where they know these people are weak enough. And as the person was telling me about this, I thought, man, that is just bad. That is bad. That is bad. And then they said what I thought we were coming to, and they're in the church every time the door opens. I somehow knew this was coming. Do you think they're listening when they're in this? When they're in the church? And this is what this person I was talking to is dealing with. He's dealing with a struggle of protecting those that he loves from those that can consider toxic, or those that are using these people for their gain, their benefit. I think all of us recognize the struggle. A lot of us have been in it. They use their church attendance as a step to climb up on and look down on others. That's never a reason to be in church. Don't ever forget, and I say this to me, bad decision I made 20, 30 years ago could have had me out there on that street corner. It could have had me going to a meeting every Thursday, hoping I could make it through another day without taking something in. A dumb decision driving home when I was 18 could have had me blocked from the way of life that God blessed me with. And I could have hurt somebody. And many of us have those things. So when we come into a church, it's a hospital. It's never a museum. But sometimes folks don't see it that way. And sometimes folks try and use that and also try and use what they know about other people to get their own way. We all do it to an extent, I believe, but sometimes it gets bad and you're hurting others to do it. And that's not right. And this is just one example. Co-workers, family members, friends, complete strangers can try and pull our strings all for no reason, or different reasons, things they consider important. Things that are important to them mean very little. I'm not really big into psychology today, but I found an interesting article called Manipulative People. 9 signs of a manipulator. Number 1, they lack insight in how they engage others and create different scenarios. They know how to do it, but they don't really care what it's going to do to you when they do it. The emotional trauma it will cause you. The financial issues it will cause you. Manipulative people don't understand the concept of manners. When they get mad or they don't get what they want, they will bring up the most hurtful things from your life, not as a way to help, but as a way to get what they want. There's a difference if I bring up something in someone's life as a way of saying, you can do better, you deserve better, you don't need to do this. There's a way, but if I bring it up and say, it's a loser anyway, why aren't you doing this? Why aren't you doing that? I bring it up and beat that person down with it, I'm manipulating someone. A manipulator avoids responsibility for his own conduct by blaming others for causing. Now, if that don't make some veins pop into your mind, nothing will. I think a lot. want to know that. A person like that, people like that, they're not going to own it. Manipulative people prey on our sensibilities, our emotions, and the fact that many of us are conscientious people. Inside, most people want to do the right thing, but there are those that prey on that. And they try and abuse that. They try to cater to your kindness and goodness at first, praising you for the wonderful person that you are, but over time, that goes down while the need goes on. And I don't mean to sugarcoat things, I don't mean to brag on you, but gratitude's never a bad thing. Gratitude's never a bad thing. One easy way to discern manipulators, find out what's on someone's heart if they're manipulating, pay attention how they talk about others. So I guarantee you, if you get a crowd of four, Tom walks off, and they're telling you what a horrible person Tom is, guess what's going to happen when old Mark walks off? That Mark, he's man, he, I look there hiring for paperweights, that's all he's good at. And when he walks back up, we're buddies. And that Tom is the sorriest thing that ever happened. Faces are popping up right now. That's a good way to look at a manipulator. Never waste your time trying to explain who you are to people who are committed to misunderstanding. It used to really, really bother me sometimes, it still does. But I've come to the conclusion in this life, and I'm borrowing a quote from someone I can't remember as I give them credit for. You will always be the villain in someone's story. Whether you deserve to be or not, you always will be. No matter how you try and explain it, that person is going to make you a villain. Even if it is for something, for not giving them the means to destroy themselves, you're a villain. And that's hard. Most of us want to be liked all the time. And it bothers me. It still bothers me sometimes. When someone doesn't like what I'm doing or doesn't like what I'm saying, but I go back and I look at it and is he in here? If I'm doing what's in here, who's really got the bigger issue? And it's hard because nobody wants to be that person that, oh my God, you ruined my life. How? Someone's, if they want you, be a bad person, you're going to be a bad person in their eyes, no matter what you do. If you categorize people by their actions, oh, it's all right, I have to already. I'm running my mouth a little much, Greg. Another way, watch how people walk more than how you listen to them talk. More of the same versus what are they doing. Manipulators talk a really good game, but when it comes down to it, who's actually doing the work? I knew a lady one time that there's very few people I get instant dislike to. But this guy she brought in, yeah, you're number three on my instant dislike list. Congratulations, you're in the top three. By the time they ended their relationship, she was the only one working. She was providing for him, yet he had beaten her down and manipulated her to the point that she thought she could make him value. His actions and his talk were totally different. If the individual puts as much effort into being a good person as they end up, trying to pretend to be a good person, they could actually be a good person. Like these people I was telling you about before, they're in the church every time the door is open. Are they listening? Everyone they're coming into contact with, are they going by this? Or are they going by what they want? They're out there. They're having the contact. They're just not doing it. And we also have to look at what we believe. It's very easy to get twisted and turned around in this world. And fool, people are real fast talkers sometimes. They can have you believe in that something is right and it's not. And they can have you down a road where they're manipulating you. And it starts off small. And before you know it, you end up your head and fall bending. Good way to check and see if you're going in the right direction. 2,000 years is still good. And if that person didn't send you down something that corresponds with this, take a good look at that person. It'll be hard, but it'll be worth it. Now, with all this, and looking at psychology today, I wouldn't be right if I didn't look into God's Word. What it says about this. Even after all these centuries, the Bible is still relevant in today's world. The day now will only ever do. God's Word isn't just a collection of letters, and poems, and books. It's a living, breathing necessity. So many verses, so many writers of the Bible go back to its importance. I encourage each and every one of us to read scriptures every day. You can't get enough food for your soul one day a week. It doesn't have to be chapters. Like, I read a few verses a day. I share them on Facebook. And it has to be, you have to have it every day, because our journey, we're never meant to stay in one place with Jesus. We're meant to grow. We're meant to walk on His path. If you become stagnant, that's one of the worst things that can happen to a Christian, because we think, well, there's nowhere else to go. There's always, when you accept Jesus, that's the beginning of the journey. We always grow. We want to get closer to Him, closer like Him, and we'll always fall short. None of us will ever be exactly like Jesus, but in our attempts to get closer to Him, we become better. And we become closer to Him and closer to where we need to be at. Some people try to twist the Word around to justify or cover what they do, like the people I was telling you about. Some people read it and show them what to do and where to go, like a compass being used in a fog filled valley. You probably have heard me, and you don't hear me say it again. Jesus, Lord and Savior, daily honest prayer. Doesn't have to be fancy, the honest. God, I need help. This is what I need to do. God, what do you need help in? What do I need? What, how am I part of your work? And regularly feed with God's Word, even a verse a day. Jesus prepares us to children. Children need proper diets. Spiritual feeding is part of that. You pray all day long. You know the Bible backwards and forwards, but if you don't have that other part of it, where Jesus says, your Lord and Savior, you're lost. Satan knew Scripture. Pharisees knew Scripture. Satan knew Jesus was the Son of God, but he didn't bow before Him. Pharisees missed it. Jesus says in John 14:6, I am the truth, the way, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. There's no room for interpretation. People are going to try and test Him, though. People are going to try and manipulate Him. You end up kind of like these guys that we're going to look at. Jesus and His disciples were in Jerusalem. Pharisees and a group called the Herodians, they were wanting to kill Him. They were wanting to manipulate Him. They were trying to trap Him, trying to make Him look bad, trying to come up with any reason for the Romans to capture Him, trying to kill Him. The Herodians were members of a non-religious Jewish party. Pharisees were religious. A lot of times they clashed. They had one thing in common. They hated Jesus, wanted to hate each other. So they combined to try and trap Jesus. And what they have against Him there, they disliked Him. They grew to hate Him. They accused Him of many things. expose them for who they were. You think about a manipulative person. When are they the most toxic? When are they the most aggressive? When you expose them. When you take that pretty mask off of them and you expose them in the light of day for what they are. That's when they run your name into the ground, into the mud. Most of us have had it happen. And that's what they're trying to do with Jesus. And one of the reasons they were so aggravated with him was because he dared eat with sinners. This man associated with sinners. Now, give you an idea, that would be like me right now, if I was a Pharisee, I'd have one of those acrylic things that follow, like right up here, because I wouldn't want to associate. That's the same thing. Jesus changed it. That had been going on hundreds and hundreds of years. And along the way, the Pharisees had made tons of money from their system of changing out money. They did it with interest. They had people that sold animals for sacrifices, they paid them part of it. So there was a financial issue, and there was an issue where he exposed them as being hypocrites they were. Because God never meant for his servants and the people they're supposed to serve to be that far away. And it was ugly. And Jesus exposed it. Exposed them for the manipulators they were and how they were manipulating their office, what they were there to do, for what it actually was. They hated Jesus most of all, though, because he claimed to be from God. As time went on, he dared to make himself equal with God. He was the Messiah, and they missed it. When you have a manipulative person, how many times have you really found out the reason why all this stuff occurred? It was just because they didn't like you or they were jealous of you. Or jealous of everyone around you. They didn't have the eyes to see or the faith to understand that Jesus was Christ, who had been predicted over 400 times in their scrolls. They had access to the entire Old Testament at this time. Christ had been predicted over 400 different occasions. They missed it. He went up to him and said, "Teacher, we know you're truthful and teach the way of God and truth and defer to no one because you're not partial to him." You're trying to butter him up, trying to make him feel good. "Oh, you're just so good." Pride and vanity can get us into trouble. Pride can be our biggest enemy because it makes God our enemy. Pride and vanity can be backdoors for Satan to attack us, much less other people with bad intentions. When are we easier to convince? When someone's shooting us down or someone's laying compliments on us? I find myself listening and looking less when someone's paying me compliments. I think it's a human thing. When we look at Jesus' 40 days and 40 nights in the desert, when did Satan try to tempt him? Beginning of it or at the end of it, when he was weakest? And how did he try to tempt him? If you're the Son of God, turn those stones to bread. Use your power. Jump off this cliff. Because it's said in the scriptures, the angels will protect you. You won't even bruise your foot. Ego. That was one of the ways he tried to tempt him. Jane Austen said, "Vanity and pride are different things, though the words are often used synonymously. A person can be proud without being in vain. You can be proud of where you're from. You can be proud of what you've accomplished. You can be proud of how you carry yourself. There's nothing wrong with that. Pride relates more to our opinions of ourselves. Vanity is what we have others think of us. That's where we can get into trouble. When someone has that image of you as a class clown, and then you do something because that's how they're all looking at me, and then you get into the principal's office, was it such a good idea? Why'd you end up there? Was it because of something you wanted to do, or was it because you thought someone else was looking at you, and that's how they expected you to act? Proverbs 11:2, when pride comes, it comes dishonor, but with the humble is wisdom. Then they set him up. They showed him a coin. And they talked about, is it lawful to give poll tax to Caesar or not? They tried to set him up with flattery. Appealed to his ego and his vanity by telling him how smart he was. And then moving in for the kill. Because Jesus was trapped in between two rocks with this. What does it say about their pride and vanity today? How many of us can relate to what's happening with Jesus? People that try to hurt you or use you with your own words. What did Jesus do? He knew what was in their hearts by his godly nature. We can improve with how we listen to people. Listen to understand what is being said before replying. I heard some a few years ago. There are two reasons to listen. Listen to understand, listen to reply. I hate to say it, but I have to remind myself to listen to understand. Because as that person's opening up their mouth, I'm thinking about what I want to say to them. And that's not necessarily what I want, what I should be doing. I have to remember, listen to understand what they're saying. James 1:19, but everyone must be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. Well, I'm one out of three. It's sometimes my mouth goes into gear before my mind does, and certain words are just like cutting me off in traffic, and it's something I work on. Wisdom and discernment. Those are two gifts we should all be praying for and asking God for daily. Discernment is knowing what's on people's heart. Sometimes I pray for people to give them discernment, especially when they're in a rough situation and you're dealing with rough people. Know what's really on their hearts. People can say a lot, but to have an idea, what are they actually thinking, what they actually want. King Solomon is considered one of the wisest men to ever live because he asked God for wisdom instead of riches. Prophet Daniel explains in Daniel 2:20, blessed be the name of God forever and ever. To whom belongs wisdom and might? David wrote by the Psalms, fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. I think that is not as much being scared of God, it's just recognizing this is where we come from. This is where all our smarts come from. Proverbs, blessed be the one who finds wisdom and the one who gets understanding. James, a couple of different times, we lack wisdom. Ask God for it. Jesus used his wisdom in answering these folks. Man, God didn't put it out here good. Cool. There we go. What's a Facebook service without some type of technical issue? Jesus knew what they were doing. He point blank asked them, why are you testing me? You hypocrites. He knew what they were up to. There are times when we know that someone is trying to manipulate us. It may be fairly innocent, or it can be very dangerous. The Nigerian prince who emails us that he just needs a way to get his money in the country, that can be fairly destructive. Your kid, have a little snack before dinner as you're setting the table for it and about to put it out, that's fairly benign. Why don't we do something sometimes when we know we're being used? Many times it seems easier to go with the flow to avoid potential conflict. Sometimes it is, but sometimes it isn't easier. What does it do to us to be continually used by someone, whether they're a stranger, co-worker, friend, or family member? It builds up. Somewhere in inside each of us, it builds up when they know that we're being, know you're being used. And we all have a capacity. And it gets to that point, and then it's, whoa! So really, which is better? Talk to them by the beginning, or wait till it blows up when they ask you to pass the salt and pepper? Jesus, for these manipulators, said, show me the coin used for the poll tax. They showed him a denarius. The denarius was a coin used as tax money at the time. It was made of silver, featured a picture of the Roman emperor on it. When the inscription called him divine, that was a big time no-no with the Jewish folks. They considered such images like idols, like the golden calf and the Philistine idols. It was forbidden by the second commandment. This was another reason why, if Jesus answered yes, it's okay to pay on the tax, he'd be in trouble. You're supporting idols. His acceptance of the tax lawful would have been a rejection of the second commandment. Commandment that would rain into the ground. He says, no, the Romans would, that would give them a reason to contact Romans to come and arrest him, that he was inside your riot or inside your revolt. Jesus asked him in verse 20, whose likeness and inscription is this? They told him Caesar's. And he answered with just the coolest answer that I never could have thought of in a million years. Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. And hearing this, they were amazed, scratched their heads, and walked on by. He walked the tightrope and stopped the manipulator. A group of manipulators that were bent on his destruction. When Jesus said, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, he was drawing the sharp distinction. He was trying to teach them a lesson they didn't even realize it. There are two kingdoms. Kingdom of the world, and Caesar holds the power of that, and the things that are in it. But there's another kingdom, not in this world. A lot of the folks in first century Palestine, when Jesus was born, their idea of the Messiah was military. Someone that would come and free this country, which hadn't been free in so long. Wipe the Romans away. Jesus wasn't that type of leader. He will be in the second time coming. Christians, we're part of both these kingdoms. At least right now, while we're here on earth. Under Caesar, we have obligations that involve material things. If you don't render unto the county of Anderson their taxes that belong to the county of Anderson, you might be walking. You might have a lock on your house. That's part of what we have to do. I used to work with a doctor, and he's one of the smartest guys I've ever met. He was a doctor in lived in Knoxville. I was a nurse at an ER in a little town called Maryville. He had a 10-year battle going with the IRS. Because he said that income taxes were illegal. And I'm like, more power to you, I'm going to H&R Block. Because I don't feel strongly enough to carry that path. I would have to carry that flag. Because Leavenworth and busting rocks wasn't really my thing. But he was just, he went back and showed me through all this and not, you know, the where the income tax came from and all that, but yeah, that's a fight I'm not willing to, I'm going to go with flow on that one. There are certain things we have to do to be part of this world. We have to make a living. Have to pay our taxes unless you're a really good tax attorney or you keep changing your name and moving from one place to another. Under Christ, though, we have different obligations. They involve eternal things. Caesar demands money. He didn't tell him anything spare. The money he ain't gonna take with you. It's part of the obligation for living in this world. Caesar minted coins. He had a right to demand some coins in return. That was his right. After all, his image was stamped on what he made. God's image is stamped on our soul. It's His. That's what we render unto God. Caesar is due, send temporary stuff in this world. But make sure to give God his due. There'll always be people out there trying to find the perfect trap, whether it's to snare you for their emotional satisfaction, for financial satisfaction, for what we talk. There will always be someone out there trying to use you and manipulate you. The Pharisees and their buddies thought they'd found the perfect trap, a way to kill an innocent man. They just had to pull his strings. Didn't work like they thought. Lessons learned from this, what Jesus used. Wisdom and discernment from God, they're becoming treacherous. Maybe there's someone right now who's listening to this, is tired of being used by someone else. As a closing prayer, look in your spiritual mirror. If you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, come on up. I'll pray the sinner's prayer with you. You can't stand up to the storm of the manipulators on your own. Godzilla, dust storm. Maybe you have accepted Jesus, but you fell away. And it happens, I did. I fell away. Life got tough. I turned in another direction. Thankfully, he kept coming. He kept knocking. In Revelation 3:20, Jesus said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come into it and will dine with him and eat with me." That's basically your big family. I'm here. I want you. I know you left. I'll let you. Let's all pray for godly wisdom and discernment. We need to be used by God, not by others. If we want to help someone, that's what we're going to hold. But make sure we're helping for the right reasons. Then get everybody to stand with me. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer and in music and message. Heavenly Father, thank you for letting us come to you in prayer. Father, each of us, each of us have to battle people that want to manipulate us in our lives. And we just ask that you be with us, give us wisdom, give us discernment, give us direction, Father. Help us to see what they're actually doing and what the words actually mean. Father, we're going to be used by anyone, anything in this world. Help us be used by you. Help us be your hands and feet. Reveal your will for each and every one of us. Prepare us for all you've called us to do. And Father, let you be the one that pulls our strings in this world.